Support for the show today comes from your mom. Oh, hey, thanks for tuning into Real Garbage. Just hit that subscribe button if you haven't already. Give me a follow. I'd really appreciate it. And now here's something you might have missed on the last episode of Real Garbage.
Monster Man comes in and starts shaking the door repeatedly, like at least speak up and be like, occupied, somebody's in here. And the guy goes into the next stall. No, I'm screaming at the TV, don't let him do it.
Well, you signed the agreement, give us your kid.
You see these hands? This was smooth. Great ass.
And now coming up on this episode of Real Garbage.
And there's those two stoners that show up. They're like, what do you think it is? Oh, I think anybody's alive. Well, the door's still closed. Kaboom. Blast the kid with the door.
I wrote down rip stoner kid because I thought he was dead when he got hit by that door.
It looked like it.
Yeah.
But then he gets up, kind of dusts himself off. Car doors are heavy.
Yeah.
Like that's 100 pounds hitting you in the chest at full speed.
Yeah.
You'd be vaporized.
Yeah.
But no, I guess.
No, he just gets back up too. Fine. Like
strong
a second
weed,
later.
He just kind of went limp. Yeah. He's like, well, that's the trick when you get hit by a door. Just go limp.
So this Baron Samedi is, I can't even.
You can't even. He killed him while we was fucking. What's the most you've ever lost in a coin toss?
I am joined once again by my very funny friend, Jayden Worth. We sit down to review the terrible, terrible Nicolas Cage movie, Drive Angry, on this episode of Real Garbage, right after a quick word from our fake sponsors.
This episode of Real Garbage is brought to you by Big Island Real Estate. Are you $12 million in debt and need to buy a giant island to do personal private stuff on? Well, you're in luck, because here at Big Island Real Estate, you can buy Nick Cage's old island. It's the only island we have. We need to get rid of it. There's been a lot of bad publicity about private islands lately, and it's really hit the fan for us in this trying time. So please go to Big Island Real Estate and buy Nick Cage's island. It'll be sweet. I promise you.
This episode of Real Garbage is also brought to you by allthingsnicolascage.com. Need a Nicolas Cage blanket? We've got it. Need a Nicolas Cage tracksuit? We've got it. Need hand towels with Nicolas Cage's face on it? We've got that too. Here at allthingsnicolascage.com, you have everything to meet your Nicolas Cage needs. Just go to allthingsnicolascage.com and use the promo code REALNicolasCageFace to save 10% off your first order. That's allthingsnicolascage.com.
Real Garbage!
Hello and welcome to Real Garbage, the number one Nicolas Cage review podcast up here in Nanaimo today. Yeah. I'm joined again by Jayden Worth. How you doing, Jayden?
Bonjour. I'm doing good. I am doing great, actually.
It's funny that you just mentioned that Nicolas Cage tracksuit, because when I shoot this at home, my guests are always sitting on a couch, and I have a brown blanket. And yeah. I just recently looked on Amazon for Nicolas Cage blankets, and there's like three or four different ones. Nice. So I'm going to get one, but I think I'll check wish.com first, because I can probably get it for $5.
Yeah. No, and I want that tracksuit, and I'm going to spend too much money on Nicolas Cage, all things NicolasCage.com. Cause I want Nicolas Cage stickers. I realize that I need them. I need so many of them. I actually, it's crazy. I've been buying so many things online now, because we're not going out. So like, I've accumulated so much shit I don't need.
That tends to happen.
Yeah. Speaking of me actively wanting to buy Nicolas Cage tracksuits.
You don't need it.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I've been buying so much, and like literally everything, and like all the things that we like usually do are all so much like based on not doing anything until you actively like absolutely have to, right? Like even like we were talking about bouldering earlier, going to the climbing gym, and like you have to sign up online in advance, and then you have to go like do a health check online and all that kind of stuff, and then you show up and literally you're not supposed to talk to anybody, really. Like you can't be in the same area as anybody, so you literally just you set up everything online, and then you go in and you just like climb in silence, like by yourself, and then leave. It's weird.
See, I don't find that at, because I climb in Brentwood Bay at Stelly's, mm-hmm. and it's still, like, we were staying apart from each other, but it's still a very social thing. Mm-hmm. We kind of just go in there under the guise of, like, you wash your hands before you come in. You're always masked up. Yeah. You sanitize when you come in.
Yeah.
And then they try to encourage you to wash your hands after, like, every 5 minutes or so. I'm like, no.
Yeah.
I look at it this way. We're all in there climbing because there's like a maximum of 16 people on the downstairs part and then four upstairs.
Yeah, so it's way it's way smaller here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How many people are climbing in the gym at the where you go?
The whole bouldering area is probably only half the size of this living room.
Oh my goodness. Yeah. That's too small.
Yeah. And it's like it's all up and it's like there's a decent amount and there's probably like there's like at least hundreds of different routes that you can do. Like there's a ton of them. There's holds everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's packed in, but it is like a small like kind of covered area that's only
Wow.
And they've got features in it. So like a part of it like comes down and around and lands. So like there's an oret that you can come around and stuff like that. And there's an area on the front side that has bigger holds, but you can't do it anymore because it's so kind of a small space that if you climb on one of the bouldering on one side of the bouldering wall and you fell off, you'd fall into the desk area where like the front desk person is. And there's like it's just like mid wooden gate towards the desk area that if you fell, like, so you have to have a spotter. So I go alone because I don't have any friends. I'm not allowed, I guess the government said I'm not allowed to have friends.
Yeah, that's kind of sucks.
And I guess that's kind of the thing is like I go alone. Like I wish my wife isn't that into climbing, but I see like that when I go, there's only allowed four people at a time. And so I usually go, and I go great in the morning, as like so 9 or 10 o'clock as soon as they open.
Yeah.
Usually on Saturdays. So if you're in Nanaimo, come see me.
You need a climbing partner.
Yeah. And there's always like almost every other week there's like this two people that's a couple that come.
Mm-hmm.
And they're talking the whole time, and like I talk to them sometimes, but I'm still relatively like kind of new there. I mean, I go a decent amount, but. Like I'm not like around a bunch.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe that's why it's kind of, I'm quiet, but like, I really love it, man. It's so fun.
It's such a great workout.
Yeah.
I found it was funny. I put on 10 pounds during the pandemic. And then once I started climbing again, I lost that 10 pounds immediately. Cause it's just, you don't think about how many muscles you're using at once until you do a couple and you're like, holy crap, everything hurts. Right
now. And you do a couple and you think like, oh, it's like, you're just climbing, right? It doesn't seem like, but it's like I wouldn't describe it as cardio, but it's like like you're breathing hard and like you're you know your heart rate's elevated, like it's a lot, especially me because I'm a big guy, like I'm lifting a lot of weight going around, like, you know, and so that's why I'm not hanging upside down and stuff like that. I'm not the best climber, but I just like doing it.
Hey man, you're climbing, that's the important thing.
Well, and the only reason I started going to this place is because we used to go down last summer, last summer, Nanaimo River has like a bunch of bouldering spots that you like, you have to like get into the river and swim to. And you climb up the side of the rock. That's like, And so there's all these different routes that we've been finding and just looking and like swimming up the river for 2 hours and being like, hey. And so that's like double the workout too, because you're fucking swimming up river.
Yeah.
You just hop from like outcropping to outcropping, going, hey, that looks like something you can climb, and it's nice because you climb up and you just drop into the water if you fall, and just got to be careful of not donking your head off or anything, but it's super sweet, dude.
I know what I'm coming up to do
in
the summer.
Fuck yeah, dude.
Because I came up to the Duncan Boulders back in May last year, on Mother's Day, actually, and we had the Duncan Bouldering Guide, and there's just a ton of routes out there.
Is there?
There's lots. Like, cool. Dude, make it a point to go to Duncan Bouldering.
Holy
fuck, Duncan Boulders, because like you park in one spot, then you go walk about 40 minutes into the bush, then it's just boulders everywhere.
Holy.
It's all, like, if you get the Duncan Bouldering Guide, it's all mapped out.
Yeah, yeah.
All the routes are pointed out. It's so cool. It's pretty sweet.
Wow. I want to get a mat is the thing I got to do next.
Well, mat's good. And then out of Duncan, we found like four other mats. And
oh, they were just there?
And people are pretty cool. Like if you use them, just make sure you put them back where you found them.
Yeah,
everybody, the bouldering community is pretty good like that.
Yeah.
Like we had two mats, we brought them out, but we ended up finding four. So we ended up like just laying out a ton of mats. So I was like, good, we don't have to move them.
Yeah.
But we were climbing with some really good climbers. Man, there's some people out there that, like, I wish I'd been climbing since I was a kid.
Yeah.
I only started 3 years ago because there's people out there. I'm like, man, you developed your body as a climber. I'm very envious of how much you crush these.
And even just stuff like that you don't even think about. Like, now I've got, like, five different hand workout things because, like, you see, like, there's this boulder that I was walking on last year in Nanaimo River, that is like the river has like washed out a bowl, in the side of this rock from like an eddy coming around.
Mm-hmm.
And so what you got to do is climb up this arete to get to this bowl, and then to get to the place where you can stand up, that's kind of the top of the route, to get up onto the like the bank of the river, you have to like smear your feet on the bottom of this bowl, while pinching into a crack that's maybe like this big.
Oof.
So you're sticking your fingers in there and trying to get like, there's this one hold where you've got to stick your finger in, grab one, and then you're literally just holding on by these two on like a little thing and reach over this way to grab the other side. So audio is probably awful. But like, just stuff like that of just like being on like, oh, I need this finger to do this boulder. I need this finger to be stronger. And it's like, how the fuck, like how do you do that? You know what I mean?
So I've got curls.
Like, yeah, I've got a bunch of different hand exercises now that I was like, if I was doing this when I was seven, my hands would just be beefed. Like I got pretty big hands in general. And so,
there's so many different skills and techniques you got to work on.
Yeah.
It just takes time.
Yeah. And I'm so glad that's the thing that I like about Nanaimo specifically. And more than Victoria is that we're way closer to everything. Mm-hmm. There's no good swimming spots in Victoria. The Nanaimo River is beautiful and it's fresh water. It's not fucking Thetis Lake. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then, we're an hour from Mount Washington. Right?
Yeah, this is a pretty, I have seriously considered moving to Nanaimo in the last little while.
Same weather.
Same weather. Like, I just right now, I just have such a convenient job. I'm landscaping. I'm a 3-minute drive to work. It keeps me fit, keeps me outside, kept me working through the pandemic. But I'm like, man, I got friends up here. Like, you're up here. I got other people that I know up here that are doing like creative stuff, like making videos and sketches and vlogs and stuff. And I'm like, man.
And there's a lot of young people. You kind of forget because you think UVic, there's so many young people. But like with VIU and some of the small businesses around here, there's like a community of young people that are doing really cool stuff.
And I find the young people out here, they're just so much more laid back. Like you go to Victoria and there's a lot more, like you feel kind of like more social justice warrior type people.
Yeah, kind of
like protesty kind of people. And I'm like, why are you like
just
this? Like,
cliquish down in Victoria.
Just chill out and enjoy. Like, I understand there's shitty stuff going on, but you can't be fighting all the time. Yeah. You gotta just enjoy life.
Yeah, and I can tell that. So yeah, it's nice up here because I don't have to drive around as much because I fucking hate driving. Driving makes me so angry.
Yeah, me too. Drive angry.
I hate myself.
Hey man, I love it. I love it.
This movie is garbage.
Absolute garbage.
Like maybe the worst movie I've seen in the past couple years at least.
I guess you watched a lot more garbage than you. But no, that's a fair assessment of this because it was bad.
Trash.
Was
really trash. Bad. Yeah.
I'm going to explain to people what it is.
Yeah.
Drive Angry, 2011. Nicolas Cage is a man possessed. He's been murdered. He has escaped from hell. And is trying to track down the men who killed his daughter and kidnapped his granddaughter.
And we don't know any of that
for
a very long time.
I only know this because I read the description of the movie. Yeah, they don't explain it till about an hour and 10 minutes in. This is an hour and 45 minute long movie.
Okay, so this movie is just... Okay, I got a couple problems here, and I just got to process it.
I got more than a couple.
Fucking Milton?
John Milton, the devil's advocate.
Okay, Milton, that's what everyone calls him. That's his kind of name in this movie. Nick Cage, Milton.
John Milton, yeah.
You wrote a script. You got together with people. You wrote a script. You submitted it to wherever screenplays go. You know, there's like that blacklist of all the screenplays. You know, yours got picked. It got made. Nick Cage is starring in your movie. Fucking Milton.
What would you have named him? That's a better question. That's a good question.
I don't know. Like fucking Jack.
It was John. John Jack.
Nobody called him that. Well, nobody called him John.
They did mention his name was John Milton in one point, and that's when I was like, whoa, hold on. Because I'm like, this has been used in The Devil's Advocate. Al Pacino was John Milton in The Devil's Advocate.
Okay.
But I looked up who John Milton was. He was just some poet from the 1800s. I'm like, okay, so there's no real significance to this name.
This movie is made up of scenes from other movies that were done better in other movies.
This movie was
every
so
single
bad.
Scene. The opening scene. where they're
ridiculous.
They're chasing the like the he's so movie opens. There's three dudes in a car, and they're like driving down the road, being hunted by at this point what I assume is Ghost Rider. Okay,
Johnny Blaze.
Can you see him? Like
where is he? He's behind us.
Yeah. And then he pulls some wackadoo ass driving maneuver and they can't see him. And then all of a sudden he's in front of them and they pull off the road and they crash. These three guys who you get no introduction to. And I think their names in Amazon Prime was fucking driver, fucking middle, fucking passenger.
Really?
Yeah. No joke.
On the X-ray?
Yes.
Thing?
Yes.
I didn't see that.
Which is gold, because then when they get out of the car, he proceeds to ruthlessly murder these guys. And I didn't realize till half, I have it in the notes, so I'll bring it up. I didn't realize till very late in this movie that this movie was filmed in 3D, was supposed to be all 3D.
That makes
sense.
It was
called Drive Angry 3D. And so when you see him like throw the bat or you see the bullet at the end, like there's
the
so much.
Shells coming.
Exactly.
Yeah, I was like, was this supposed to be 3D?
Yeah, it was. Wow. The movie was supposed to be called Drive Angry 3D, but then they just released it as also not 3D because, you know.
I hate 3D movies. I hate them.
They're awful.
Ever since Avatar was the best one ever. Everything else since then has sucked.
I didn't even really like Avatar, hot take.
Oh, man. Well, I watched my mom try to grab the bubble at the start in the theater. She's like, whoa. I'm like, Mom, it's a movie. Yeah. It looks so real. Yeah. I was like, so that's how real it looks.
Yeah.
So I was like,
it's not Muppets 4D, Mom. No. Calm down. But yeah, so there's so much in this movie that makes me so upset because every scene is from a different movie. I have it so many times. It is just, this is another movie. But he ruthlessly murders these three guys, trying to figure out where his daughter is, I guess.
Granddaughter.
Oh, granddaughter, the baby, yeah. Yes. So these guys are, I guess...
Where's my baby girl?
Involved in, yeah. But why is he... Because you just did his voice, which I guess is just Nick Cage's voice. But why is he doing the Cameron Poe voice?
It's because he doesn't... This is what Darren told me in that Between Worlds episode. He did some reading about it. Years ago, Nicolas Cage said, I don't act anymore. I just be me. I'm just myself.
Yeah.
He's just Nicolas Cage. He doesn't play characters because he says he hates playing characters. So he's not playing John Milton. He's being Nicolas Cage. That's what Nicolas Cage does in every movie. He's just playing himself.
No, because look at me. If he's playing himself, then that sex scene later in the movie makes me very uncomfortable.
Wow. Wow. I can't wait till we get to that. And so, yeah, he says, where's my baby girl? He kills these guys, shoots the gas. Now, I don't know. We discussed this in the last movie. Embers won't start gasoline on fire, but I'm assuming sparks off of a... They absolutely would. So that's realistic. When sparks he shoots the shotgun at the ground, hits the gas, it blows it up.
Okay.
I think that would work.
Yeah.
And then it's like, boom, drive angry.
Yeah, this movie is very violent.
Oh, it's ruthless.
Yeah.
Ruthless.
Yeah.
Cut to Amber Heard in this. We get introduced to her. She's telling us how she's cut off her boyfriend. No sex. He's not getting any ass. He's not getting any tits until he marries me. I'm like, that's grounds for like he's just gonna dump you, because that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard.
Well, and also like what there's this weird kind of dichotomy that in this scene of where she's saying like I want him to marry me, but he's also like kind of a deadbeat. Do you understand? Like, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's kind of the vibe I got, and there's definitely the vibe you get later.
Oh, yes. He's a message yet.
Yeah. And what makes me upset is that we find out later the movie Drive Angry is named after his license plate. It's his car that they're driving around that says Drive Angry as the license plate.
Oh, I didn't notice that.
Yeah.
Which in the Chevelle or the Charger?
The Charger.
Oh, the Charger. Oh, I didn't see the license plate.
Yeah, it says Drive Angry.
Oh my God.
Isn't that stupid? Why is it his license plate?
Yeah, because Frank, well, he's a piece of shit. We don't know if he's angry or not, though.
Yeah. So anyways, Nick Cage is in this diner, and so he goes into the diner that Amber Heard is in and fucking just makes out with that one lady.
Oh, she is a horny waitress. She's like, so when are you gonna ask for my number there, darling? When are you gonna ask me to get out of here?
Grabs her by the head.
And is like, I wanted sugar.
Yeah.
And it like, I was expecting her to be like, oh, yeah.
And then he just
dumps
so much sugar into his coffee. That's wild.
I guess when you're in hell, you like sugar.
Yeah.
How would he, okay, We need to point out that he, in the opening minute of this movie, it's like a voiceover talking about how this son of a bitch is in hell, and then he escapes, and we got to catch him, blah, 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 and shows his car jumping out of hell.
Yeah.
Because hell is a prison, apparently, and Satan is the warden of prison. He escapes. So he's dead. He's dead. Why is he drinking coffee? Why is he drinking anything? You're dead. You don't need anything.
But he's back alive.
But he's not alive, though. He gets shot in the face later, and he dies and comes back. I'm like, you're dead. You're a walking corpse.
No, it's like a Wolverine situation, I think, later, where he heals.
But Wolverine never did anything but just smoke cigars. I don't think he ate.
Shit, maybe you're right. I have never seen Wolverine eat.
Doesn't eat.
Maybe he's from hell, too.
Wolverine's a zombie.
Shit.
So, yeah, okay, anyway. So this piece of crap boss here.
Yeah, because she gives muffins away for free, and muffins he's free. Like, muffins, free.
Here's some warm milk for you on the house. Ah! Yeah. I would throw it in her face. Get that shit out of here. Yeah. Warm milk? Who wants warm milk?
I'm not even a huge fan of milk in general.
I like ice cold milk. If it's cold and I'm eating like brownies or cookies, you got
that's not nature's way, Jeff.
Fuck nature.
Okay, fair, I guess.
I'm fucking natural warm milk. That's what I mean. Nature's cool. Warm milk, not cool. And she quits because this boss is like, hey, how are you going to pay for that? The muffins.
I wrote it down somewhere. He is.
That actor's been in a lot of stuff.
Every cop / firefighter in the background of a movie is him.
Firefighter, yeah.
The firefighter.
He was in, Rescue Me?
Yeah, he was. He was the chief in Rescue Me. That's why I said firefighter. He's also a firefighter in like four other movies. I know that. Hey, I love Rescue Me.
Once you get, I watched the first like 3-4 seasons. I don't know if I ever finished the series.
It's weird.
It was good though.
Yeah, it becomes like almost a soap opera drama kind of thing by the end. So I understand why.
That's where I lost it. But yeah, I exactly. Want her car. Oh, the 69 Charger?
It's his car.
Or his car. I want his car then.
Yeah.
It's so nice. Yeah. It's so nice.
This movie is brought to you by Charger, apparently. Because when she goes to drive away, like the engine, like the lights flick up and you've got the Charger logo there. Mm. But I guess they have a Chevelle later, so it's not really.
454.
Yeah.
Chevelle SS. So he realized, he's like, oh, whose car is that? And he's like, oh, it belongs to her.
Yeah.
So he sabotages it. She pulls over. He just walks out of the woods and is like, I can fix
creepy
that for
as
you.
Fuck.
Oh, yes. She is way too trusting. Yeah. Way too trusting.
And like, and so, and also, what, there's two times in this movie that he fixes a car by just opening the hood and looking at it.
Yep.
And then this time he literally like it looked like he toned a knob and was just like, she's good. And that was it. And then they get in the car and she goes, I don't pick up hitchhikers.
I didn't have my thumb out.
Yeah. And, but my thing is, why did you've picked up a hitchhiker? You saying I don't do this well doing it means nothing. There's
like
no
when you're sleeping with someone, you're like, I normally don't cheat. It's like, oh, you're cheating right now.
Yeah, that didn't make sense.
Frank.
Okay. So she gets home after driving away, after quitting her job because her creepy boss. Which I don't even want to talk about.
No. We don't have to. It's irrelevant.
Yeah.
It's a reason for her to quit.
So yeah, she quits, she drives away. She's starting to become detached, like she's, you know. Doesn't have a job anymore, I guess, and he doesn't have a job, but she gets back, and this doesn't happen, this trope in movies, where people walk in on their partner's cheating.
I've seen it before.
In movies?
It's been a while.
In movies? Yeah. I mean, no, it happens all the time in movies. Like, it's a, you know, it's a classic, like but I don't think it's ever happened in real life.
It's never happened to me. Yeah, I've never heard of it happening to someone else. Yeah, it definitely is just a movie thing.
Yeah, for sure.
Or maybe people just don't like to talk about it.
That's
it
fair.
Does happen. Like, I wouldn't want to be like, oh man, I walked into my girlfriend getting railed by two dudes. Yeah, oh, that was
shitty.
It sucked.
Yeah. But anyways, so, and he gives the classic, she was just showing me something, as I think what he yelled.
She was just showing me something. That's what he said.
Yeah.
And then she's out there like, we're in love, bam.
No, so because she was saying, I think she was going to say, we're engaged.
I thought she was saying we're in love.
No, because she didn't say the end of it because she said, we're in, and then she punched her, and I think it was going to be engaged because he didn't engage with her, and that's why she was so angry. I think.
She should have drove angry.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was, and then he proceeds to just beat the hell out of her, which was like, man, that's hard to watch.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, she started it, which I don't believe that. No, never mind, that's not true. But what I'm saying is, she did lay into him a couple times, punching him.
Yeah,
and I would never have done what he did, and you shouldn't, and it's awful, deplorable, the worst. He's an asshole.
I'm surprised Nicolas Cage didn't walk over and go, "We don't treat women like that."
That would have been amazing.
Because he does it in other movies.
Yeah. But, and the only thing I meant by that is, because I realized it sounded bad, was just like she shows very quickly that she is angry and like is inflicts violence, is all I was saying.
Spits blood in his face.
Yeah. And so what I meant by that was not that he should have done anything or was justified, obviously not. What I meant was that there was a very linear amount of, she starts with, you know, grabbing her boss by the nuts and then beating the shit out of that lady in the street, and then trying to beat up her boyfriend. And then slowly it's just exponential growth of killing people.
Oh, terrible. By the end, she's like a straight up murderer.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Okay. So we also get introduced to the accountant here at one point after they drive off in the Charger on the side of the road.
Oh yeah. They're taking out the trash and the honey waitress.
Oh, Colonel Sharp shows up from Armageddon and, he's like, "I'm looking for this man. He looked like this," and blah, blah, blah. And then she's like,
"Sharp from your right. What else is he in?"
I only knew him from there.
Bad guy in movies is what I call him.
He's been in so many things.
He's been in so many things, and he's always the kind of like joke bad guy. I feel like that's what he does. You know what I mean? There's some actors that just do bad guys.
Why'd you bring a gun on an asteroid? So, yeah, he shows up, kind of puts the fear into that horny waitress, but she still wants to bang him.
Yeah.
Lady, come on.
And you never see her again, so there's just a weird tension for no reason.
Have you ever watched Eastbound and Down?
No.
Oh, dude. It's Danny McBride. It's a baseball
Danny
pitcher.
McBride fan.
It's a good show. You see her,
oh, my
see,
God.
You see
I
her
like
tits.
Baseball movies.
You see her tits. It's a series. It's like, it's like five seasons.
Oh, okay.
It's HBO. It's so good. I recommend it. Eastbound and Down.
I'll try it.
We get introduced to him. And at one point, I wrote down, of course it's Florida. Because they mentioned Florida. I'm like, oh, yeah. Okay, this makes so much
They're in
sense.
Texas and going to Florida.
Is it?
Yeah.
Because
they passed through Oklahoma.
Oh, I don't know my states that well. Because I thought at one point he said, you're never going to find another guy like me in Florida. Maybe in Texas, but
that's
not Florida.
That's because they're in Texas.
Oh.
And she wants to go to Florida.
Oh, that makes so much more sense then.
Yeah.
Okay, well, it's Texas. Texas is just as bad.
Yeah. If not, woes. This accountant guy. See, you brought up that, I guess, in the opening, you see him drive out of hell.
The first minute is like, it's the accountant going like, blah, 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 something about hell. Somebody is, and he's jumping his car over this ramp and driving out of hell. And he's like, so you got to chase him, bring him back kind of thing.
Because I must have missed that, which is very integral.
Opening minute of the movie.
I must have missed
like,
it completely.
You see hell.
That's why I wrote, is it Ghost Rider? Is this Ghost Rider? Because it was, because flames in the car. But I didn't connect that as him escaping from hell. I thought it was just opening credits scene.
Oh, it was.
And so this whole time I was trying to figure out he kept saying the accountant. I was like, is he God? Like, who's Nick Cage?
He's like, what do you think you are? Like, you think you're Loki? You think you're him, the devil himself kind of thing?
I
think you're Loki?
but Loki or Baron Samedi is what he says.
Yeah, I don't know who Baron Samedi
is. Me either.
I'm not up on my hell history.
I highlighted it so I can look it up, which I will do in a second. But he says, I'm the accountant. He's like, well, like, why would I care? Oh, how does it, how does that affect me or whatever? He says some stupid
Oh, this is where
thing.
He's talking to Frank? So where is at Frank's place questioning him? Are we there?
No.
Oh, no, we haven't got to Bull by the Balls yet.
Yeah, exactly. Because he was like, the restaurant owner.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Was like, is that supposed to mean something?
That's right.
And then he said, it will if you end up on my books.
Yes.
And so I put together near the end of the movie that his whole thing is just making sure that the balances are equal.
Yeah.
In the God vs. prison hell, like just making sure everybody's going to the place they're supposed to go.
Mm-hmm.
Right? With the I'll see you in 3 months kind of thing.
Yeah.
But
I'll
it took
see
me
you when you're 73. I'll see you in 3 months.
Yeah. But it took me till that scene with those two stoners, which again, we'll talk about later, to figure out that he was the accountant, like figuring things out.
Ah.
So I had no idea what the fuck was going on.
Yeah.
This whole
see, you
movie.
Missed that first minute. If you had got the first minute, you would have known what was going on.
Well, also look at me. No, I would not have.
Yeah. Well, at least you understand that.
Because I did see it. Because I wrote, is this Ghost Rider? So I did see it. It just didn't make any sense.
So we get this weird flash of Nicolas Cage to like, we get introduced to this Jonah King cult leader.
Yeah.
And I put together that this is his daughter because he's trying to track down his. I didn't even know it was his daughter. I'm just like, oh, it's just some woman with a baby. Yeah. She gets her throat cut. And I thought because he takes the baby first and all of a sudden he goes, ah, and like this light bursts out from underneath him. I'm like, did he just fuck that baby?
No.
Or did he absorb the baby into him?
The lady bit off
somehow?
His dick.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
That is what happened.
Well, it just seemed weird, though, because...
And she also stabs him in the chest with the with his necklace.
In the was it in the eye?
I don't know.
Yeah, stabs him in the chest later.
Yeah, he's got to stop. First. I wrote it down. He's got to stop wearing that. We'll talk about that later.
Yeah, don't wear weapons around your neck.
What I wanted to say was that if fucking Billy Bob Thornton ever gets a biopic later in his life, they got to tag this guy forward.
Well, I thought this guy looked like Neil Diamond.
I don't know.
What Neil Diamond. Bet your balls is Neil Diamond. He's a singer.
I don't know. I don't know what he I know who Neil Diamond is. I don't know what he looks like.
Oh, okay. Well, to me, you don't think this guy looks like Neil
Diamond. Think he looks like Billy Bob Thornton?
A little bit. Younger Billy Bob Thornton.
Yeah, that's what I mean. That's okay. Why, yeah.
Okay, yes, yes. Then yes.
I thought you were going to be on board with that, Jeff, and I had to
convince you
this dude looks like Billy Bob Thornton.
Neil Diamond, question mark, drinking human blood? Because, yeah, that scene's gross, where he, like, kills her, and he's like,
yeah,
look at his fingers. I'm like, gross.
Cults freak me out, man. Like, just, well, they don't freak me out, because I'm interested in, like, a lot of stuff like that. But, like, when you get into that, like, weird... Like,
human sacrifice cults?
Yeah.
It's a little too far. Yeah. Listen, I'm all for the orgies and dancing outside naked, but no. the human sacrifice.
No, see, again, not even really the problem. My issue is with, like their thought process on it is so weird to me. Like, at least with normal cults, like Jonestown, he was just insane. He wasn't just like, I guess he thought he was God. But like when he, like that huge suicide thing, it's kind of interesting to me, just like how people's mind works and stuff like this. Mm-hmm. But something about this stuff where it's like drinking blood and like just weird for just to be weird. Especially in this movie that it's just so elevated.
Yeah, and they take it to a extreme in this too. I'm like, all right, like this isn't something you want to watch with some kids around.
Yeah, holy fuck.
So they go to Bull by the Balls. I thought that for a second that the guy that greeted him at the door was Kyle Gass from Tenacious D, but he just kind of looked like him. But this is now the second time that we hear somebody go like, "You're supposed to be dead, aren't you dead?" Because they make comments on that all along the way that he was dead.
Yeah,
he's been killed, and everyone's like, "I saw you die."
Yeah,
but. And he's like, "Well, are you going to kick me out of here?" He's like, "Oh, you're going to cause trouble?" He's like, "Not if I have to, not if I don't have to," or something like that. They end up ordering a couple of drinks. I felt like all of the women in this show, this movie, were very, very forward.
Almost unacceptable level. Like, all towards weird-looking blonde mullet Nick Cage.
Yeah, because he's not an attractive man in these days. Like, I don't even think he ever really was.
Well, I disagree with you completely, but that's fine.
To each their own. But yeah, the blonde hair was not working for him, at least in my opinion.
Oh, God, no. No, no, no.
It was horrible.
No.
And his hairline, he should just shave his head.
And, dude, the way, if he, again, you're saying he just does Nick Cage, which makes me so upset, because...
Just plays himself.
I wish he would keep playing the Nick Cage from, like, the 90s, where he's, like, on British talk shows, just, like, cocaine and doing handstands, you know what I mean?
Oh, he's this new, I don't give a fuck Nicolas Cage, is just, like, mailing it in.
Yeah, just
weird. He's got 106 credits to his name, now he's just, like, he's quantity over quality these days.
He's got to buy those islands.
He does. He's got to sell it.
He's got to sell those islands.
So this is where we get the, because she leaves in there. She's like, "I'm going to go have a shower in a nice comfy bed. You get your..."
Wait, so we haven't done...
The sex scene's coming up here.
No. We haven't done the...
Did I miss something?
For some reason, I thought...
Because we get the drinking human blood flashback, and then they go to Bull by the Balls, and then the accountant goes to talk to Frank. Yeah, sorry, I got 2 points ahead. The accountant goes to talk to Frank.
Yeah.
And he breaks that baseball bat in half, impales him on the wall.
Upward on the wall, which you could die just from that.
Oh, yeah. That looks so painful.
Yeah.
And that was a pretty cool scene. I actually kind of like that.
And again, if it was filmed in 3D, like...
That,
like,
baseball bat flying.
That makes sense. Ah. And it was because he throws... So he gets the information from Frank of where 6-1... Like, he's using his sniffer to figure out what the fuck's going on. He's smelling Nick Cage.
I felt like he could smell Nick Cage everywhere.
That was the point, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
If you got that impression, then that's
I'm looking for a traveler. 6-1. He was around here. Which way is he headed? Yeah. And then he was always sniffing around and goes, yes.
He's been here.
Yeah. So Frank called the cops because she steals his car.
Yeah, he thinks that this is a cop that showed up in a suit in Texas.
Yeah. And so he gets the information he wants from Frank, kills Frank with that baseball bat, and then goes outside, and the cops have arrived.
This is a pretty cool scene.
And so the other cop goes inside, and again, maybe people like this in movies, but I thought it was unnecessary. When he threw the bat, you knew what happened with that bat. You see it from Frank's view coming at his head, and you go, that bat hit him in the face for sure and stuck into his head. There's no way it didn't. And then the cop comes inside and just close up of bat in head.
Gore.
Yeah.
It was pretty gross.
Yeah. See, and so stuff like that, like especially immediately, like with the blowing that dude's knee off with the shotgun in the first scene, I was just like, okay, movie, okay, like let's take about 10% off of there, but
strap in, we're in for some graphic violence.
Yeah,
I did like this scene though with the account where he's like, oh, it's your lucky day, and he flips that coin up, and they all. They're both looking at it like idiots because these cops are just dumb.
Yeah,
and then the pow catches it and he's like FBI.
Yeah,
they're like what?
Which come doesn't on. What? Does
but
it?
It did work because he was playing it off like he was following this guy, and now he was at a new crime scene. Like he got there before the cops.
Yeah, for sure.
Like, oh, this is you're involved. You're involved in an investigation.
But
now,
is
guys.
The is it like a because I wrote it is the magic coin some sort of Men in Black.
It must be
like
some
laser
sort of
thing,
devil coin. He can turn into whatever he wants.
Well, because if he flick, because he both times he does it to be an FBI, but he flicks it in the air. If I was like, oh, coin, and then he's holding an FBI thing, I'd be like, what the fuck was it with the coin, dude? Unless it was some sort of like
he just flipped it out of his sleeve,
phaso device. Yeah,
but this is just goes to show how dumb these cops are.
Yeah.
Like, oh, they. Oh, wow, he's FBI. Better believe him. Yeah.
And then we saw that Nick Cage has a Dungeons and Dragons esque briefcase that's supposed to look old, but just looks awful.
Weird. Yeah, I'm like, it must be an old gun of some sort.
Yeah.
With full of vials of stuff. Cool.
So anyways, Candy is the waitress, and of course her name's Candy. And they, so Amber Holland and Nick Cage are at this bull and balls or whatever.
Bull by the balls.
Bull by the balls. And they go, they're each to each their own person to go have sexual relations.
Nails, she wants to get her nails done. Nails pain.
Oh yeah, I guess so. And so she finds a guy to that. I love in the next scene because she's like, she goes and talks to this guy and like steals. He's bartender there, or
he's a server,
a busser, yeah. And she like steals his towel and he's like, oh, he's like, I guess I'm quitting my job, like gonna get fired to go have sex. But they leave, and then the next scene, he's completely naked, huddled on the bed painting her nails, and I was like, hilarious.
Like, are we gonna have sex soon?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know. You messed that one up. Yeah. Keep going, and there.
And then just in the background,
Jesus, she's fully naked. You get tits and everything, and he's got all of his clothes on, sitting down.
Well, you never take your clothes off before a gunfight.
Well, I guess you don't take them off during sex either.
But he's got his sunglasses on, and he's in this weird, like postopedic, half with 45-degree angle, and she's on him, and it's just
arched back, just giving her
wild him, and his sunglasses so on, man, and he looks like wax. He looks like a wax museum Nicolas Cage in that movie, in that scene. It was so weird, and she's like screaming, right, hollering, but she's also hollering like, move it.
Move that cock.
She's just like,
move that
something.
Dick. Come on, because he's just doing absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
But she's still just loving it, hamming it up. And then Jonah King shows up because apparently he has laid some bait. Like he said, oh, they took the bait because he's set up some sort of trap. But he doesn't really explain what the trap is to attract Jonah King and his cult. It might have been, probably because he killed the first three guys.
Oh, yeah.
And that would be the bait. But they wouldn't know where he was headed.
Yeah.
So this is another one of those instances in a Nick Cage movie where they don't explain how people know where he is, which just drives me nuts. I'm like, it doesn't make any sense, you guys. Please explain this to us. But whatever. We'll suspend our disbelief again, I guess.
Yeah. So all these guys come in. And this is my thing, is that the accountant we know from his fight with, his name? Frank. He has super speed and like time slowing,
super
ability,
strength, I guess.
And so I was wondering if Nick Cage does. I don't think he does in this movie because
just the regeneration, like Wolverine.
Yeah, because he was so. All Jonah King's henchmen all come and try to kill them, and they're having this huge gunfight.
This is while he's still inside of this waitress,
laying on top of her. She's completely naked. He's firing his shotgun and chugging whiskey.
The 3D makes so much more sense now because the buddy comes in with an axe. Throws the axe, it comes at the camera and
just
cuts a chunk of his hair off. And you're like, what the hell was that?
Yeah.
Blows that guy away. I also wrote down, blast the guy. Oh, with his 9mm, he shoots a guy through a window. Just
blows him back 20 feet. I'm like, wow, 9mm are powerful, I guess.
Yeah, like the end of Django Unchained with that lady. Just goes flying. Yeah.
He also shoots the guy with a machete, shoots his machete, and knocks it back hard enough
into his head with the back of a machete.
I'm telling you, this 9mm was possessed by Satan.
Yeah.
It was so powerful.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, all while still inside this woman. Yeah. I'm like, what?
And then Amber Holt comes in and mulks two of them. So again, she's killing mom, man.
And then they escape, and now the cops have shown up with the accountant. She shoots a police officer.
Yeah.
He jumps up, and she just... Bah!
But they did open fire on them pretty quick. So the accountant is now with those two cops. He convinces them to come.
That's true.
Everyone's dead except for Candy, I guess.
she's just traumatized.
Yeah. And then, so they go to leave, and the accountant's there with the two cops, but the accountant doesn't go in, which I thought was weird. Like, he stays outside and sends the two cops in, and they get totally destroyed, because they just go in and just start opening fire on this dude.
Well, because they're told to use lethal force by the accountant. Like, well, it kind of goes against what we do. It's like, nope, I'm authorizing it.
Which does
There's
it go against...
There's a promotion in it for you.
Does it go against what they do? Because if you think about later, the other cop guy is like... Aim for their tires, yeah.
When I say tires, I mean head.
Yeah.
Shoot for the tires.
Yeah, I've got a lot to say about that guy later.
Me too. So they escape in the car, and all of a sudden it's like, whoop, whoop, whoop. And he's the accountant's in a cop car now, and they're doing a little side-by-side over the bridge, and he's
talking.
Like, prep that gun for me.
Yeah.
She has no idea what it is.
No.
It's a gun from hell with weird, vile bullets.
That is my knowledge as well.
And she's just like, here you go, and there's your gun. And he shoots out the window, grazes his face.
I'm not even sure I could load, if somebody gave me just a random gun in general, I don't know if I could load it properly. I know how to load some guns because I've shot some guns. But like if somebody just gave me any gun and was like, load this, I'd be like, I don't know what I'm doing.
Especially like, I don't think she has a ton of experience with guns. She doesn't seem like she has military training or anything.
And
like
she also doesn't seem like she has a lot of knowledge about the fucking supernatural.
No.
Which so hell gun is kind of maybe a couple steps too high.
Hey, this has never been seen anywhere in the world. Sure, I know how to load it.
Yeah. And there was like, vials with like liquid and stuff. And like, I guess, so she loads it and this guy, the accountant, I guess has no idea that Nick Cage has this gun. Cause he's Baron Samedi.
Yes.
Oh,
you look up who Baron Samedi is.
Yeah. You think you're Loki? You think you're Baron Samedi?
He's surprised by this gun. Cause he's like, cause later on he's like, how the hell did you get this gun out of hell?
Yeah.
So they blow him off the bridge. Crashes. They stop. She goes to look over. She's like, oh man, he's dead. And then what's funny is that they were just cruising down both lanes of the bridge, cutting off both lanes. And he crashes. They stop. Now in one shot, it's facing the other way. There's a truck driving way down the road. So that leads me to believe there was a truck following the both of them.
Yeah.
Witnessed that cop car go over the edge and just went. Nope. Not stopping for that. Gonna keep on going.
Yeah. So yeah. Cause he shoots it and it grazes him.
And then just blasts the side of the car out enough to turn it sideways and throw it over the side of a bridge.
Yeah. And it lands like face down. Well, I guess cars head down, top down.
I do love the accountant as he's falling. He's just like, boop, 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 drumming on the steering wheel, like, no big deal. Smash, boom. And there's those two stoners that show up. They're like, what do you think it is? Oh, I think anybody's alive. Well, the door's still closed. Kaboom. Blast the kid with the door.
I wrote down rip stoner kid because I thought he was dead when he got hit by that door.
It looked like it.
Yeah.
But he gets up, kind of dusts himself off. Car doors are heavy.
Yeah.
Like that's 100 pounds hitting you in the chest at full speed.
Yeah.
You'd be vaporized.
Yeah.
But no, I guess.
No, he just gets back up too. Fine. Like
strong
a second
weed,
later.
He just kind of went limp. Yeah. He's like, well, that's the trick when you get hit by a door. Just go limp.
So this Baron Samedi is, I can't even. I can't even.
You can't even.
He's a Loa of the dead in Haitian voodoo.
Oh. Okay.
So I guess.
Very obscure reference.
So I guess this guy is kind of like Baron Samedi, though.
Hmm.
Isn't he? Because isn't he the one that makes sure people are dead or not?
I guess. They're tying up a whole bunch of different religions.
You think you're
Baron
Samedi?
So now we're back at the crime scene, and we get introduced to the captain. This guy's walking in. He looks like Stan Lee.
He's fucking...
Sunglasses and this cop. Okay, you get hired at the police station. I'm pretty sure you're probably going to know who the captain is. This rookie's like, whoa, 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 you can't be walking through here. And he's like, rookie, calm down. This is the captain. And he's like...
And also, who the fuck is this captain trying to be? He's wearing one of those shirts that has all the, like, movie spoilers on it. You know what I mean?
Tucked in.
Yeah.
Belt cinched up real tight.
Yeah.
walking in like he's a badass. He's like, you're standing on evidence there, rookie.
This whole thing was stupid. I wanted him to be Jeff Bridges from Hello High Water. Is what I wanted.
That movie's so good.
Such a fucking good
movie. It's a great character.
Such a good movie. Everything about that. I love that movie so much. But that's what I wanted. So when it came on, when it was like Captain, I was like just so disappointed. I was like, what? This could have been so good.
They talk to Candy and she's like,
I didn't hear a word she said.
No?
No, oh, I didn't hear anything.
Quote, he killed him while we was fucking.
He killed him while we was fucking.
We get a little more backstory on Jonah King. He was into satanic magic. The daughter was in the cult and she tried to escape. So yeah, this is Cage telling Amber Heard all this.
Because he was in prison.
Yes.
When that's how, what is his guise of how he hasn't been around in a while.
Yeah. Meanwhile, he was dead in hell. We find out later that hell is just a prison.
Yeah.
And that just leads and there's so much more information.
Yeah, and in a second, there's fucking going to be some pretty, like, because he explains it. The way Nicolas Cage explains hell is that you just have to sit in this prison and watch the suffering of all your loved ones. He's like, it's not even that you get tortured.
No, this wasn't. He didn't reveal this yet. This is later on. This is by the burn barrel. Because they're just driving down the road, and all of a sudden they're like, hey, look, there's Jonah King's van. Pull over. And they just pull up to a church. There's Jonah King's van and all these vehicles. And
which
they
just
into
pass
this.
By. And also, why is his... Wait, is Jonah Hill's van...
Jonah Hill?
Matt Black.
Jonah King.
Oh, Jonah King. Did I say Jonah Hill?
Yes.
Whoa.
Ask me about my wiener. Yes, Jonah King is driving around in like the van from old school.
Yeah, a matte black van with bad red flames on it. Made me so happy.
And they walk into this creepy, creepy church where
and
everyone's
they're all
just,
singing.
It's the scariest. Dude, and to me, I'm like, I would have turned around and walked right back out. That's
and
too creepy.
And also he walks in and it's like, so he knows they're all there and there's like a decent amount of them. And he walks in and like Jonah King doing pretty well for a cult leader. He walks in with his shotgun and he's just slowly sauntering around. And like, I'm never a satanic cult, but I've been to a church where if somebody walks in, at least one person's like, hey, there's somebody here now. And especially if you were doing satanic cult things, maybe you'd be like, hey, maybe we should keep an eye on the fucking dog.
Put a guard outside.
Yeah. Well, we're chopping off these babies' heads. Maybe we should pay more attention.
But everybody was in on this. They're like, everybody yeah. pulled out a gun. All of a sudden, like, freeze. Yeah. Gotcha. I'm like, oh, it was a trap.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, of course.
Interesting. Why would you walk into that? Like, it just seems stupid. None of this was explained.
And so, and because we don't know he can heal yet either. We've mentioned that too early because we don't know that. Because I wrote down, I think he can heal when he got shot in the face. So, because he says...
Oh, yeah, this is only 45 minutes in. Of course he's going to come back.
You say, give me the baby. He says, give me the baby. Oh, give me the gall. Oh, I'm going to blow all your heads off. And they're all like, haha, how are you going to do that?
Yeah, I got your baby right here. Put your gun down. Oh, crap. So he puts the gun down.
Which is, again, stupid.
He gets shot. And then we have, like, the most aggressive scene of them removing Amber Heard from this church.
Yeah.
Like, a good 2 minutes of her just, fuck you, motherfucker.
Getting pulled out.
Kicking everybody. And they're like, man, we're going to have some fun with you. I'm like, Jesus Christ.
Then,
like, it doesn't need to be this long.
Yeah, and then every 20 seconds, because it had enough time to be 20 seconds in between, you just get a fucking overview of...
Yeah, him
Nicolas
dead,
Cage.
And then her kicking and screaming more. I'm like, again? Yeah. Really?
And then back to him dead? Like,
we get it. He's dead.
And like, what I thought was at least going to happen, and maybe it did, but I tried to check, and I didn't write anything down because I didn't see it, is that I thought maybe every time they panned back down to him, it was less blood and shit.
It wasn't.
But it wasn't. No. It was the same because it didn't change till he got back up.
So they get her out of there, and then we cut back to him dead, and this is where we see the greatest and worst toupee I've ever seen. The dude looked like it was a blackberry colored black, larger, and just like Legoed to his head.
It literally looked like Lego hair.
It did.
And
it
like
crazy.
Not even Lego hair, like it looked like it was a different piece, but it had a shape to it that was just so
like bubbled like a blackberry or like a berry of some sort.
And it like nobody said anything to this guy.
Dude, you gotta cut your hair.
Dude, and if you gotta get rid of the toupee.
Just shave your head, bro.
Yeah,
it's not working.
Yeah,
because it was like out to here.
Yeah,
like an afro, but not an afro.
I noticed it immediately because it was just in the background. And I was like, "Yo, what the fuck? Hilarious!" And so, I at first was like, "Oh, it's just a throwaway." And I just wrote hairpiece, like is all I wrote because I was like, it was just one. I thought it'd be funny if I brought it up because if it was just one scene, but
that henchman's toupee.
Yeah.
Holy shit!
Yeah, it's just it's in like you have to like. I mean, go watch the movie if you want to. It's a bad movie. But if you don't want to watch the whole movie, just go. Can you put
40,
in
47 minutes or so? And I will put that.
Yeah, put it in, please. You have to, because it's.
We'll bury them out back.
Because again, well, I think we'll just go having it the best way you could. But it's just not. It's still, you can't.
You're going to look at it and go, they nailed it.
Yeah.
It's exactly what they said it was.
Yeah.
So this is where I wrote, Cage is back. Is he going to drive angry? Question mark. And yes, he is.
Yes.
Because he catches up to this RV, the Winnebago, I was calling it. And all of a sudden, the bad guys that are chasing him just come out of nowhere. I'm like, how? Like, from the side. I'm like, how do they know where he went?
I guess they took like a shortcut.
I guess.
Because they know the area.
Alabama shortcut. Or what
Oklahoma.
Oklahoma shortcut.
Yeah.
So there's a Winnebago fight. And then,
Okay. So I've got a couple things to say. Okay. Cause sorry for cutting you off. Okay. Cause this RV, they're in the RV. Amber Heard's in the RV. He's chasing, Nicolas Cage is chasing after them. They figure out that Nicolas Cage is chasing after them because Jonah King's sitting there and hears the engine off in the distance and goes, that must be for some reason. Like it couldn't just be somebody driving fast. And then, though, as they like start doing some like evasive maneuvers, the mom does what might be the lady holding the baby,
the caregiver
does what might be. I don't know, I've been wrestling with it for a couple hours. Yeah, like when I was watching the movie, I kept thinking back, like, did she do the right thing? They're in a, like a Winnebago RV, and whenever I say Winnebago, whenever I hear the word Winnebago, Super Troopers.
Oh.
When they have to take...
Hey, we had a good time in that Winnebago fight, huh?
Anyways, they're in this Winnebago, and she goes, there's the top bed above where you drive, and she takes a baby and goes up there.
I didn't notice that she did that, and then there was a cutaway shot of her laying there at one point. Yeah. I was like, who the fuck is this?
Yeah,
and then there's like a shot from her outside. I'm like, who is that?
Yeah,
oh, it's the woman with the
baby.
Yeah,
it's the woman with the baby. So she's got the baby on the thing, and she's kind of crouched over him. Oh, I guess the baby's a lady. Well, the baby could be whatever it wants. Anyways, the point is that I'm struggling to see, is that the dumbest thing to do or the smartest thing to do?
That's where he wrote down shaken baby syndrome.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's a lot of shaking.
Yeah. And so, like, what? Why did she go to the upper bed? Is
well,
it safer?
To avoid the fight, I guess, because Amber Heard was fucking some people up here at this point.
I guess, but there's with the motion, like there's no...
I guess she wasn't thinking of that. She was like, just get away from the people fighting.
I guess. And my first thought was, see, and this is what I don't know, is that I was like, go to the bathroom, is what I would do. Because it's small, you can brace. But they ended up in the bathroom in the fight scene. So I was like, maybe she did make the right choice.
And I guess she didn't want to get booted out the back window, because that was hilarious. She's fighting that one chicken, all of a sudden she just goes, hi-ya!
Yeah. Yeah, it was perfect. And she like flew out sideways too. Like she like
and didn't get knocked out. She had enough sense about her to sit up and go, ah, and emptied the clip and then got smoked by her by her other cult people. Holy, just
I
got
didn't even
eradicated.
Write it down.
Eradicated.
Yeah.
Like dude. not crumpled, blown to bits.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because that's what happens when a car hits a person. They just get blown to bits.
It literally looked like, you know how you see in like TV shows and stuff like that when somebody gets hit by a bus or like movies?
Oh, yeah.
Where it's just like they're there and then the bus is fast and then they're not there. But this scene was almost like you knew what happened to this lady. You knew what the aftermath
she
of this
was.
Toast.
Yeah. Imagine being the driver of that car. You're just like, oh, man, we just killed Carol. Like, oh, well. Keep on going. So, yeah, she fights. So now she's fighting King because King's like, I'm not going to be able to break you.
Yeah.
You got a good spirit, so I'm just going to kill you now. And she's like, well, until, because he's pointing a gun at her. She's like, well, you know what? Until then, motherfucker, let's do it. And he's okay.
Yeah. And what's funny is that he was like, which I guess is fair. He's just weird. Because he was like, because he even said he was like, I'm going to defile your body.
Yeah, I'm going to murder you, then I'm going to defile your corpse.
Yeah.
Like,
so,
oh, you're creepy.
Yeah. Man. Well, I mean, I didn't really think that he wasn't creepy.
Oh, yeah.
This wasn't the turning point.
It wasn't a surprise.
Yeah. I can't believe you missed that lady bit his dick off.
Yeah, I did not get that.
Yeah.
Because some light burst out of him
when
that happened.
She bit his dick off because later they call him Dickless.
Dickless. Well, that all makes sense now.
Yeah. In the church, they call him Dickless.
Because Nicolas Cage gets to watch that. We find out later.
Exactly.
While he's standing by the burn barrel.
So, but in this OV fight scene, this dude fucking has already gotten stabbed by his necklace. And Amber Heard stabs him in the chest with his necklace again. And it's like, dude, fucking stop wearing the necklace.
And now she leaps out of the back of the RV because she's about to get shot.
and onto the car, and then Buddy
luckily just, doesn't get killed.
Well, and empties the clip at the car of not even hitting either of them.
Yeah.
And kills the car. They keep on driving, and then
yeah, because the car like rumbles out. Yeah, smoke comes out.
And he's like, "Well, we gotta ditch this car." And she's like, "Why? Why even bother?" He's like, "Cause you killed two cops." And she's like, "Oh." Oh, yeah, right. Yeah. Like, wow, that hasn't...
I have been motoring people on a spree lately.
Sunken in late yet? Wow, lady.
I was kind of like, oh, like, why do they have to... Why are they in such a rush? I guess because this baby is going to die, I realized. And but like,
full moon.
They're like, the next full moon. Like, they don't know when it's going to happen. But you can track this. Celestial bodies are trackable. You can know when the next... He knows exactly...
It's marked on the calendar.
Yeah, he can meet them where they're going at the full moon. And he doesn't need to... be here right now.
I felt like the moon was full this whole movie. They kept showing shots of the moon. I'm like, looks pretty full to me.
It's pretty
that
fucking
still
full.
Looks pretty full. When is it? So the accountant goes to talk to this bad toupee guy, gets the information, and he's like, oh, what's that mark on your chest? He's like, we have a pact with Satan. And he's like, I don't really think he knows about it.
Oh, so okay, so Frank go the accountant goes into the church.
Yes, and talks to the toupee guy.
And he says what might be my favorite line in all of history.
Oh.
He walks in and the dude's knee is blown out, and he goes, "Whoa, that's fucked." is when he sees the dude's knee, and I was just like, "That's what I want my doctor to be like." When
I've never seen anything like that before.
Fucked.
Whoa, those are fucked.
George Costanza, you never seen anything like that before? Yeah. Is it cancer? Is it cancer? Don't tell me it's cancer.
Yeah. Just a Wolves doctor for sure.
So now Cage, he's like, I got a friend who's live around here. You can help us out. So he calls up his old pal Webster.
Oh, before that, the eyeball scene though.
Oh yeah, his eye goes back to
fucking
normal. Isn't that after he meets up with Webster?
Maybe.
Because they go to like Webster's garage or something.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. All I wrote was eyeball scene fucked me up.
Yeah, Webster and him, they kind of have like a standoff because he calls a tow truck. Webster brings up the tow truck.
And it's
like,
Webster that's driving the tow truck.
Yeah.
He's got his legs all messed up.
You going to pull that 357 or are you going to blah, blah, blah? And he's like, we better talk about this because you're dead.
Yeah.
And another thing, like another time he's like, you're dead. It's like, yeah. Okay, that's like the fourth time someone's been like, I saw you die.
And so I think by that time I had caught on.
I should hope so.
Yeah, but when he got at the... Bullen balls. I didn't realize that he was like this thing. And she was like, this driver's license is an antique. and like, I didn't know any of that. Like, I didn't register at all.
That first minute.
Yeah.
And the description of the movie says a father escapes from hell.
Yeah, but I see. I don't read this description. I like going in cold car.
All right. So he's fully healed now because he calls up his Webster and then the last of his eye heals up.
Yeah.
And then he's standing by the burn barrel. And
this
Webster's,
is where they're talking about.
Yeah, Webster's
how...
like, oh, this is the story. His daughter was in a cult and blah, blah, blah. She got in deep and then he tried to save her and he was a real piece of shit, but he loved his daughter.
Yeah. Well, yeah, because he was like, he was a real bad husband, but a great father. And I'm like, I think those are pretty mutually inclusive most of the time.
You
know
really
what I mean?
Love her and fucking hate her.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, maybe you can. I don't know.
Well, you could, but if you're a really bad husband, that kind of gives you the vibe of... Gives you some Frank vibes.
Yeah, so this is where he explains what hell is. And he's like, it's not the fire that reminds me. It's the video feed. I'm like, what? Like, I actually paused it there and went to my kitchen and came back and unpaused it. I was like, what the fuck is he talking about? Then I rewinded it. I'm like, oh, it still doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, so they show him all the stuff that's happening on Earth in hell? Is that what hell is?
Yeah, because he was saying that like the Walsh part about hell is not that he has to, it's not like, he didn't say this, but this is what I extrapolated from my mind. It's not like you're like fucking walking on coals and being poked or whatever.
Not,
you know what I mean?
Not the fire.
Yeah, it's not like you are the one suffering. It's not that you're suffering because like anything's happening to you. It's because you have to watch all this dog shit happen to people that you love.
And this is a graphic description of what's happening. He's like, I had to watch my daughter get her head pulled off. I'm like, what? What?
Because that is technically what happened in the movie because he cut her throat and there was a big splash of blood, but I didn't need to know her head came off.
Yeah, like why? Like the guy's drinking blood. I'm like, now do you want to rip her head off? Like that's... Yeah. Jonah King is a piece of shit.
Yeah, and the guy's like, what's his name? What's his buddy's name?
Jonah King?
No.
Webster.
Yeah, Webster. Webster's like, you want a beer? And he's like, the only time I want a beer is from Jonah King's skull. Like, and I was like, that's something Jonah King would do.
I forgot about that line because later on is he drinking out of the skull?
Yes. And dude, I'm telling you, that's something that Jonah King, you're not really, you know, that's kind of
fucked
up.
Well, he was a shitty husband, so he's probably a shitty person.
That's fair. And so they formulate a plan, him and Webby boy. They're going to go find Jonah King.
And he's in the midst of this. He's like, he's telling me he's a walking contradiction. Now you're going to do this, blah, blah, blah. You're going to do it on your own. I'm not doing it on my own. I got to help. And she's like, I'm in it till the end. I'm like, wow, you went from like, I'm just a waitress, you know, with a shitty boyfriend to I'm a murderer. I've killed cops and yeah. I'm in it till the end.
I don't pick up hitchhikers.
Yeah, fuck. Now she's just murdering people. She's like, I'll help you kill more people.
What I did like about this movie is I never once had like the inclination that they were going to be romantically involved.
You know what I mean? He did put his hand on her wrist at one point. I was like, ew, gross.
I didn't even notice that. But like, I didn't even, ew, he's dead.
Gross, yeah. And he's Nicolas Cage older.
Yeah, yeah. Look how dirty his hair looks.
It's gross. So yeah, they got this plan and they're driving down the highway. And this, I was just laughing because, okay, they're in the car. The
I would have taken Webster. Why not? Well, I guess, well, okay, never mind. We'll talk, yeah.
There's a shot of them in the car and he looks in the rearview mirror. And you can, if you're really looking, you can barely see a cop car in the distance. And he's like, looking at the rearview mirror, he's like, oh. And then she looks back too and goes, what are we going to do? And he's like, I don't know. We'll figure it out. And all of a sudden,
yeah,
two cop cars from the side. We're just driving right at him. We're like, spinning behind him. And then you see the cop in the distance. I'm like, did they just mess that up? Like, were they supposed to be looking forward going, oh no, what are we going to do? And then, because I didn't see the cop car.
All the cops in front of them as well. And the blockade where the
aim
guy's
for
like,
the tires.
Yeah. And by tires, I mean head.
They killed two of ours.
They're fucking straight up planning a Bonnie and Clyde situation is what's happening.
So they stop. And they're like, okay, cool. They stop. And then the accountant drives. This had me just howling laughing. The accountant drives in a hydrogen truck. And he's like, boop, 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 boop.
Where do you fucking get one of those?
I don't know. Just the side of the road in Texas, I guess. And he says every cop car he hits explodes.
Yeah.
And
just violently.
This is like Last Action Hero. Just boom. No. Boom.
And then as it happens, he just fucking.
Oh, yeah.
He just gets out and steps. Like he looks like, again, you know, I don't know how I've done this twice now, but he looks like John Travolta in Pulp Fiction when he comes in and he's like, huh?
Huh?
He looks like that. He just steps out onto a cop car like,
fix
this I can
tie,
do this.
Like,
yeah.
Watch.
Yeah.
And Cage is like, get down. And just floors it in the 50 feet that he had between him and the cars.
And between two cars.
Drives under the rolling hydrogen truck.
As it explodes over two cars.
This was just ridiculous.
Yeah.
Suspension of disbelief right here, my friend.
Oh, you mean you were fully into the hell gun? The stolen
the
hell
God
gun?
God killer?
Yeah. Where do you even get a car in hell to jump out of hell prison?
That's was it the devil's car? I don't know. Like, cars have killed people in movies. Maybe those are killer cars. Maybe he was driving Christine.
Oh.
I'm really stretching. I'm really grasping at straws.
What's that movie about that tire that goes around and kills people?
Rubber.
Rubber.
We reviewed that in the third episode of this podcast.
Nice.
That was years ago.
Yeah, go back and watch that.
Four score and 2.5 years later. Burlier. So at this point.
So whose side is that? This is what I wrote down in my, and now I'm starting to piece it together as we're talking about it. But I was like, who fucking side does the accountant want to kill Nick Cage? Is he saving him?
This next
What's
scene,
his job though?
Because again, they drive under the hydrogen truck and they do he does the old stop and look and they stare at each other. It's kind of like, yep, I see you. You see me too. Yeah. They drive away and they show up at this cult party and the accountant just shows up out of nowhere and he's like, ha-ha, I got her. And he's like, how'd you get the God killer? And like, so they have a little standoff and this is where he basically is like, I'm not trying to kill you.
Yeah.
I'm just here to sort shit out. So let's fix this. So this is where he's like, oh, I need your help. And he's like, there's 40 guys down there. He's like, listen, you kill those 40 guys and I'll help you out.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, cool. So then it's like the wildest rampage he goes on. This is insane. Like, and this we find out like they're bringing hell to earth. Like Jonah King has figured out how to bring hell to earth somehow through his satanic magic.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, Cage just goes on a rampage, jumps
and is this,
the car.
Wait, no, just wait. Is this, the accountant talks to the...
To the Amber Heard and Nicolas Cage.
No, this but is, doesn't he talk to the non-Jeff Bridges? And does the coin flip again, FBI?
Oh, yeah. Sorry. My bad. I skipped that part. The aftermath of that, he does the coin flip, FBI. You're involved in a ongoing investigation.
And then they talk to each other, and then she goes, what do we do now? And Nick Cage says, now we drive, and he fucking doesn't say angry afterwards. And I've written in my notes that apparently this is the second time that he said something about driving and not said angry.
Oh, my God.
And I think that's...
What a piece of shit.
Just not putting the name of the movie in the movie so I can say how dumb it is that you put it in the movie.
You piece of shit. Yeah.
So I'm mad that you didn't do it.
Now it's the cult party. The accountant shows up, and they have a little standoff, and he's like, drop the gun, unholster it, give it to me. I just want to know how you got out with the God killer, because Satan was watching, because he's the warden of hell. And there's like, there's a bigger picture, and you're like, oh, okay. Yeah. All right. And then he's like, now go down, murder all those people, then I'll help you.
And as soon as they showed like this dancing orgy, like satanic ritual thing, there was a giant boning like pentagram in the background.
Yes.
And immediately in my mind, I was like, fucking that thing's gonna fall down for sure.
He just runs his car, jumps his car through it, jumps the Chevelle through it, and just smashes that and crushes like six people at the same time. So now he's got 34 people left to mess with. Kills everybody. And then he uses the God Killer at this point? Oh, no, he doesn't yet. She does. But in the midst of this, Jonah King, because he's just about to stab the baby when it's like, jumps in there, and he like passes it off to this woman. He goes, when I tell you I want you to kill this baby, she's like, okay.
Yeah.
Wow, you're a piece of shit.
Yeah. Well, but they also,
they are cult people.
That coin that he fucking, that coin is pretty much useless in the whole movie. It doesn't really do anything.
He does use it to murder two police officers.
That's what I'm saying. It's a fucking ninja coin. And it's literally just, I assume it's just the coin from fucking No Country for Old Men. Well, that he's the accountant, and that's how he decides if you die or not.
What's the most you've ever lost in a coin toss?
See, that's what I'm saying, is this movie is just like plot points of other movies.
That's a good point, yeah.
Yeah.
I was too high to think that hard. So
I was so high that I was thinking that hard.
And now at the end of this rampage, it's like a standoff between, this is great, Jonah King, standoff with the car, and he's like, come on, do it. Because now he has a shotgun full of like 10 rounds. He's like, do it.
Do it. Do it!
And then does he throw something at him and blow it up underneath him and blast the car into the air? Because the Chevelle flips.
I have no
idea. How does
he
blow it up into the air?
I just want to say, yeah, just one second, because I want to go back a second.
I just put blows it into the air.
Because when you were saying, like, Jonah King's about to stab this baby, and as he's about to stab this baby, the baby cries, and it, I don't know if you noticed this, but it auto-tunes the cry into a guitar riff as he drives the guy. So the baby's like, wah, wah.
Oh, we haven't even mentioned that at all. In all of these action sequences, there's like, the most ridiculous guitar riffs behind it all. Just wow, wow.
Yeah, yeah.
A lot of whammy bar, a lot of fucking bands and shit. And it's like, wow.
Yeah. And the music was not that good, because when they were in the church, he walks awful into the church. I was just like, I want to hear fucking Freeboat by Leonard Skinner and him slaughter the whole church like in The Kingsman. Again, another thing. Movie did it better than this movie.
Oh, that was a great movie. That was a good fight scene.
I didn't like it just because that one joke at the end actually ruined the movie for me. But anyways.
So she gets the God Killer. So she gets God Killer away from the accountant at the top of this tower that they're in for some reason, where he kills the two cops. And he's like, be careful. You get down there and help him. Be careful. It's got a lot of kick. And just lets her go. And then she gets down there and she shoots Jonah King with the God Killer. But it doesn't
he
kill
miss,
him.
Yeah, it misses yeah, him.
Yes, because he's some sort of
and there's only so
devil.
We have missed a huge plot point here, is that he stole this gun from hell, which we knew, but there's only three bullets. Mm-hmm. He says that to her. She's there's only three bullets left. And he was like, there was only three to start with.
He shot one already.
So he's got two more.
She just missed one.
We have one more.
Yes. And then, she misses with him. And then this Jonah King gives this big speech like, you can't kill me. I'm Tony Montana. Like, and then or like something about like no weapon on earth can kill me or nothing on earth can kill me. And he's like, this is his big line.
Not of this earth.
And just wait. So this huge kickback gun. Yeah. So he shoots him.
While he's laying on the ground.
And his kickback gun it moves his whole body backwards, but his fucking arms stiff as a bow. Like he's still aiming directly at him. He's like, gah! But his whole body slides 10 feet back in the dope. But his arms fucking, not even just a little bit, just fucking straight out.
I feel like that thing would just be coming back and smashing you right in the face.
Yeah,
and
dude.
Blasting your skull to pieces.
Dude's got fucking triceps like crazy.
But he blows him away. And he like blasts up into the sky, disappears. There's a massive vortex in the clouds.
His face melts off like in Indiana Jones, and it was awful. Indiana Jones did it better in the 70s. I'm telling you, this movie isn't just other movies.
It is. God, the more we break it down, the more I'm like, yeah. So many connectors.
That skull face, his face melted so badly, like so badly. And like Indiana Jones didn't do it well, but in the 70s, they did it better. Well, I guess maybe 80s. I don't know when Indiana Jones came out.
Yeah, I think it was like late 70s, early 80s. Yeah. Somewhere around there.
They did it better then with that than they could in this movie. And Like, I assume some of this movie couldn't have been, it probably wasn't that expensive, but it probably wasn't that fucking cheap either.
I didn't look up the budget on this one.
Yeah, could have spent an extra second melting that dude's face off.
It was bad. Yeah. Well, they're like, everything else already sucks. Forget this. And now he's just like, oh, my work here is done. Take my granddaughter. You're her protector now. I'm like, what? Huh? And you're a mother now. Take her.
Yeah, there's pieces of skull everywhere, by the way, that he just picks up and drinks a beer out of. Wow. Which, did he bring a beer then?
He must have.
Did
Webster come back at some point?
Yes, he did.
So maybe he brought them a beer. And now there's this nice little back and forth between the accountant and him, like, you know, I'm going to escape again. I'm coming back with you, but I'm going to escape again. No hell can keep me. Which is basically this little like comedic back and forth where he's like, oh, and give me the keys. I'm driving. Yeah. I'm driving us back to hell. Then there's this stupid anime. So this is like back to the start, that opening minute. The last minute is them driving back into hell.
Okay.
Just flying through the air like the magic school bus.
I mean, God's secretary, the accountant, does have a nice car.
Yeah, it does.
But he said, okay, I got to look this up. Because then when they get in the car and they go to drive away and he goes, you think you're Wotan?
I don't know who Wotan is. Wu-Tang! Wu-Tang!
Nice.
And then that's
you
the end
think
of
you're the whole Wu-Tang?
And that's you think you're all, what, nine of them? So that's the end of that.
That's it.
They drive back to hell and then the credits roll. I'm like, this was... On the scale of Nicolas Cage movies, this was down in the dumps. This was pretty bad. But I still gave it 4 Winnebago fights out of 10 tire shots.
I gave it 0 out of 3 bullets left.
What are you looking up? Wotan?
Yeah, which is a fictional character.
Zoltan.
A DC Comics supervillain, the archenemy of Dr. Fate, written in 1940. Something nobody's heard about.
Wow.
What the fuck, Nick Cage, with your weird, obscure... He said Loki, and then... Fucking nonsense.
Baron, what's his face?
Cimetti. Yeah.
Baron Cimetti. Well, that was Drive Angry. We don't need to give any more credit than that.
And it was terrible. So I realized that I thought I had said that it was 3D halfway through the movie, but I didn't until the very end, where I wrote at the bottom of the page, this was supposed to be filmed in 3D.
Did it say that somewhere, or did you just Google it?
I feel like after I had watched it, maybe I looked it up because I was like, I'm so fucking confused.
I'm glad said that because it does make sense now.
And as soon as I read it, because I think I looked up Drive Angry just to get it on Prime Video and it said Drive Angry. Just in the like first line, it said, known as Drive Angry 3D.
Huh, crazy. Well, would make more sense now with the jumping cars.
Just with
and
everything. And the bullets and like, yeah. All the scenes in the movie that I bet you both me and you were like, fuck off with that the whole time. Like,
would have been way cooler in 3D.
Yeah, 2011 fucking red and blue. Red and green fucking glasses. Like, whoa.
All right, let's wrap this up. Yeah. Bam. As always, follow us on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube. Subscribe. Hit the like or dislike button. The algorithm likes that kind of stuff. Jayden, thanks again for doing this.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it.
Yeah,
this was fun. I'm going to come up here and we're going to do this again real soon.
Hell yeah, brother.
Woo. All right. Bye, everybody. If you've made it this far, you are a hero. Thank you so much for sticking around, listening, and watching. Don't forget to subscribe, follow, hit the like button if you're watching on YouTube. If you're not watching on YouTube, you should go watch on YouTube because watching us do this is so much better than just listening. Seriously. Thanks again for listening and watching. We'll see you next time on Real Garbage.
Real Garbage.